Good morning. Y'all wondering where I'm at? It's good to see you all this morning. I like making a grand entrance every now and then. It's good to see you this morning. Hope you're doing well. And we're grateful for your presence here. Hope you got a bulletin when you came in. Inside that bulletin are upcoming announcements and activities that you'll want to be aware of. So take a minute, look through the bulletin, see what's going on, and make sure you're keeping up with everything. And also remember, we are in the midst of our Lottie Moon Christmas offering, which goes to support international missions around the world. And as you can see, we're getting closer to the top. Not too far away, but we still got a little ways to go to get those balls over and above this little vial overflowing. So hopefully by next Sunday, maybe they'll be laying on the Lord's Supper table here, because there won't be room for them in the vial. But that money all goes to support missionaries around the world and sharing the gospel. So I encourage you to pray about that. And you do have that envelope. You can participate in that if you would. You'll notice a lot of other announcements, but let me just encourage you to take a look at that. If there's anything going on in your life or your family's life that we can be praying about, please take a moment, take that connection card, tear it off, and fill that prayer request out on the back. Put that in the offering plate, and we will be sure to lift those requests to the Lord and look forward to His answer to each and every one of those. Let me open us in a word of prayer as we begin our service together this morning. Father God, we thank you for the privilege of worship and the opportunity just to gather together here this morning in your presence to honor you, to glorify you, to lift your name on high. Father God, just speak to us as this morning we get to hear from our choir sharing with us and hear from your word. We pray that both of those would just speak to our hearts and that you would encourage and challenge us in our walk with you. And then, Lord, as a result of that, we would respond to what it is you desire to do in our lives right now. How you desire to use us and mold us and shape us. So, Father, we look forward to what you're going to do, and we have a great anticipation of the impact that this time together worshiping you will have on each one of us. So, Lord, have your way with us. Find us faithful in our worship now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Mike?
Let's stand together as we sing, O Come, All Ye Faithful.
O come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing, all ye bright hosts of heaven above. Glory to God, oh, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, A new creation coming. glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us? And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those he loves? Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? 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 He is. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He
Amen. Thank you, choir, so very much. Give them a round of applause, please. Show your appreciation. The time and the work that they have put in to share that story with us is important for us to hear the story fully and to understand what this time of year is really all about. We have been talking about what we see, what we hear, our questions have been each week to that end. Do you see what I see? And we talked about what we have seen God doing all around us in our lives and in the life of our church and the life of our community. Do you hear what I hear? Have you heard the testimony of what God is doing in the lives of those around us? And in our own lives, are we sharing that with others? And this morning, our question comes down to who knows what? Who knows what? And what a fitting conclusion for our Advent theme this year. Who knows what? It's been a hard year, hasn't it? And it's been a year when it's been a bit of a struggle to answer that question, who knows what? We have been going and dealing with this virus for a year. We have dealt with a lot of other issues, even with our election as a nation. We have dealt with issues within our community and within our church. Who knows what? Seems like every time you turn around, the information changes as to what's going on and what works and what doesn't work and how do you handle it. Especially with this virus, you know, how is it spread? How long does it last? Who gets it? Who doesn't get it? Where does it go? Where doesn't it go? And how do you deal with it? And honestly, it's been a whirlwind. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of it. Seems like every time you turn the news on, the news changes about how we're supposed to deal with living in these times that we're living in. You know, the star shone for all to see. Yet Herod became enraged when the Magi did not return to give him the information that he wanted. He didn't pay attention to the star itself. He didn't even pay attention to the information that he was given by his own advisors. He wanted the Magi to come and give him information so he could react. And yet he became enraged when he wasn't given the information that he thought he deserved. The shepherds shared all that had happened to them. And yet no one paid enough attention to go back and check for themselves of this thing that they had been told, like the shepherds did. Do you know what I know? Well, probably not everything. And I don't know everything you know. You know, there are things that I deal with as a pastor that are not for me to share with you. There are things that you experience in your life that are meant for you as well. Yet what I know of God, I willingly share with anyone who will listen. And yet, sometimes we're just not that interested in listening. Sometimes we're more concerned about what we know and what we want to stop and hear what is actually going on or hear from someone else. Sometimes we're privy to information that others aren't. But I can tell you without a doubt, as followers of Christ, if you have learned about who He is, if you have learned the story that we tell here at Christmas, that God so loved the world that He sent His only Son, then you have knowledge that needs to be shared with others. I find it somewhat amusing at how quickly the lines of communication can be passed around a small community of what's happening in the community. So quickly can we spread the news of what happened to this person or what happened to that person, or what this individual isn't doing or what that individual is doing. How quickly that news can spread, and yet the good news, the greatest news that has ever planted itself on the face of this earth, finds it so hard to be spread. Oh, if it's a little bit of juiciness, we can share it with anyone. But what about the greatest news, the greatest gift ever given? Are we willing to share that? You know, the question of, do you know what I know? It's time for us to recognize what we need to hear, what we need to see, and what we need to share, to gain wisdom for what is important enough for you to know and share with others, and not allow the world to pull us in to what the world thinks is important, when we know we have the only answer that is needed. The message that was shared by the choir this morning is the message that we need to sing and shout to the world. I don't know if any of your classes, Sunday school classes, were interrupted this morning. I hope so. Because in the youth room, we were talking about the importance of shouting and worshiping God, of proclaiming what an awesome God we serve. And so I made the youth sing. Some of them just moved their lips, and some of them sang out, "Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King." Isn't that the message? Isn't that what we know? But how is it presented? We were in Psalm 95 and it says they shouted joyfully, shouted triumphantly. Oh, it sounds beautiful if someone were to sing, "Joy to the world, the Lord is come." But you know, I always, during this time of year, like to watch some of the old musicals, White Christmas, and a lot of the Bing Crosby ones. But in one of them, talks about singing out, shouting out to the world, singing with emotion, like you really feel it and mean it, like you really know it. Is it joy to the world? And do we show that it is? You know, I get amused. Gary has led us in worship a few times when Mike has been gone. And there was one time he stood up here and he encouraged you to sing loud enough for the Methodists to hear next door. Do you know what I know? I'd like you to open your Bibles, if you would, to an unusual passage for a Christmas sermon. But it's what we need to hear today. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, we will begin with verse 7. In trying to answer the question, do you know what I know? Here's what it says. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, so that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, in order that I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Would you pray with me? Father God, speak to us clearly and quickly now. Lord, help us. Help us right now, this day, to see what we already know and to understand the importance of helping others to know it as well. You have shown us great things. You have shared with us great things. You have taught us great things. And help us to recognize the knowledge that you have given us through wisdom and understanding, that we too might have the faith of the shepherds to share with everyone we come in contact with of all that has happened to us by your power and your presence. Have your way with us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Very quickly, a couple things I want to draw out of this passage to encourage us as we celebrate this Christmas season. Number one, it's for the sake of Christ. What does that mean, for the sake of Christ? Well, I want you to consider this. We talk a lot about these shepherds. We've talked about them the past couple weeks. I want you to consider something for just a moment about these shepherds. Their livelihood, their existence, their success, their identity was all found out on that hillside, watching over the sheep, taking care of the sheep, protecting the sheep, feeding the sheep, guiding and directing the sheep. Sheep are not real smart animals. They need a leader. They need someone to watch over them and to lead them. That's why in today's society, if you'll notice, a lot of shepherds will have a dog that will keep them kind of contained. But you'll also notice in a lot of areas, in the sheep pens or out in the fields. In Colorado, there are several places we used to go by where there were thousands of sheep out there. There'd be a llama out there. Why? Because they could guide the llama and train the llama, and the sheep would follow. These shepherds, their lives revolved around caring for those sheep. But when that angel appeared and gave them good news of great joy, and the heavenly host joined the angels in praising God, what did the shepherds do? For the sake of Christ, They left the sheep. They left their security. They left their livelihood. They left what they depended, their lives depended on. They left to go and see if what they had been told was true, if this sign would be fulfilled of finding a babe wrapped in cloths lying in a manger. For the sake of Christ, they left their flocks. We also talked about the Magi coming from the east, bringing gifts for the newborn king because they had seen the star. God had communicated through his creation to these national leaders that a new king was born, a unique and special king, unlike any other. How long do you think a country would stay stable in a day without internet and without television, without radio, without mail, without Amazon? How long would a country stay stable if the leader of the country packed up and left? And yet that's what the Magi did when they saw the star. They left their nations. Oh, I'm sure they put someone else in charge and held them responsible while they were gone. But they left what was of utmost value to them, and they went to honor this king. For the sake of Christ. I guess my question for us this morning is, what are we doing for the sake of Christ? I'll leave it there. Because I ask myself the same question. The second thing I want to draw your attention to from this passage that we have read is the surpassing value of knowing Christ. The surpassing value of knowing Christ. So often we allow ourselves to just leave it as is. Oh, I've received Jesus as my Lord and Savior, so everything's okay. I can go back about my life. See, there is surpassing value in knowing Christ. He says here in verse 10, that I may know him. That's where it begins. See, becoming a Christian is not having the knowledge that God loved the world so much that he sent his only son to live a sinless life, born of a virgin, to die on a cross, to pay for my sins, to conquer death and be raised from the dead, and having that knowledge and saying, okay, great, I got the knowledge, I understand, God took care of me. And that's that. To know him is an intimate thing. Years ago, when we planted a church, one of the songs that was coming into worship services at that point made some people uncomfortable. Because the song said, Jesus, lover of my soul. And it just made some people uncomfortable because that term lover in our society is used in a different way. And for some people, they just didn't feel that was appropriate. And yet, as I study God's word and I engage with him, I realize that it's that intimacy of knowing him. It's not knowing about him. It's not knowing the facts of him. It's knowing him intimately. Do you know Jesus that well? Because he is the lover of your soul. There is no one Who loves your soul more than Jesus? Do you receive that love? Or is the love that you receive just the words on the page, that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life? The words just roll off of our mouth because we've learned the verse and we've memorized it and we've had it for years, and I still let it come out in King James English. But do you really know him? Do you have an intimate relationship with him? That's what Paul's talking about here. That's part of the surpassing value of knowing Christ, to know him. But the second part is to know the power of the resurrection. To experience it. See, again I say, in Scripture when it talks about knowing, it's much more in depth than having knowledge. In fact, just to put it bluntly, we're told that a husband and wife know each other. That's the consummation of the marriage, when they come together physically, is to know one another. It's that level of intimacy in our engagement. How well do you know the power of the resurrection? You know, it's important for you to know the knowledge about it. We've talked about this, and we let it go a lot of times. The power of the resurrection. God called down, and the stone was rolled away, and Jesus came out of the tomb. The power of the resurrection. But the knowledge doesn't stop there. You've got to remember that God was, the power of the resurrection was so powerful that it spilled out on all the other tombs in that area. There were people walking out of the tombs that day. People who had died years before. But it's more than that. Are you experiencing that power in your life? That's what it means to know the power of the resurrection. Are you experiencing the power of God in your life? Because God is at work. God is at work in my life. God is at work in your life. God is at work in the life of this church. The third item in the surpassing value of knowing Christ is that we know the fellowship of his suffering. For me, he suffered that I might live, that I might be free. But you know, there's also some suffering that comes with knowing Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. There is a suffering that the world doesn't understand that is part of your life and my life. You know, when you love completely, with that comes some hurt at times. Because when the ones you love hurt, you hurt. That's the fellowship of suffering with Christ. There are times when, because of our faith, we encounter a form of suffering. But that's part of it. Of knowing the fellowship of his suffering. And then the fourth is to know that I am conformed to his death. I am conformed to his death so that I might be made alive. Are we fully engaged in that? Do we know that? It's not just a fire insurance, folks, that you know Christ and you're okay. It's much more than that. It's that you have life, that you have been made alive, that you are a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. the gift that you have been given through Jesus Christ, born in a stable, wrapped in cloths and laid in a manger. The gift that you have been given gives you life. What was dead is now alive. What died in the garden with Adam and Eve has been made alive in you because you have been conformed to His death. Not yours, but His. And you're made alive. Do you know what I know? You see, I know that Christmas is the celebration of God's love for me in sending His only Son, born of a virgin. I know His plan for my salvation is evidenced in a babe wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. I know that His commitment to me of His Son's suffering, even to death, and the power available for my life shown in the resurrection. I know that that's what God has for me. I know that His desire is that I live my life in such a way as to encourage others in their relationship with Jesus. I know that He opens doors for me to walk through and take action, to serve and to minister to others. I know that He expects me to serve Him and His kingdom more than the will of man. And I know that I want to do His will with my life so that I might please Him, not man. Do you know what I know? This Christmas, I want to encourage you to take time to look around, to see what God is showing you. I want you to take time to listen to what God is telling you through His Word, but also through the testimony of others that you have contact with regularly. And I want you to think about what you know and how others can come to know the same. Because that's what we're here for. Jesus said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you." Do you know what I know? Let's pray together. Father God, the knowledge that we have, that you have given us, that you have shown us, that you have told us, that you have brought to our understanding, the wisdom that you have given us is for a specific purpose, and that is to share with others as well, that they too might know you, might know the power of the resurrection, might know the fellowship of suffering, and might know that they have been conformed even to death with you. So, Father God, have your way with us. Help us to remember the greatest gift that we have been given is not meant to be held so tight that no one else gets to know that we have it. Help us to remember that the gifts that are given are meant to be received, and that we have been entrusted with the ability to give, not just to have. Father God, I pray right now that your Spirit would move in a mighty way through this place. That we, like the choir has testified before us this morning, might be able to answer all of those questions that Mike sang out of who you are and all that you have done. That we might be able, because of what we have seen and what we have heard and what we know, we might be able to say He is about you. You are faithful. Your love abounds. And your desire is for us to be a part of your family intimately, to know you, and to make you known to others through our lives. So may your Spirit have your way with us right now. As we celebrate the birth of our Savior, that we would honor you with the knowledge that we have been given, to act upon it for ourselves and to share it with others. Lord, be blessed and glorified by the faithfulness of your people, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite you right now to stand. We are going to have a song of invitation. The question is, what will you do with what God has said to you? Through the presentation of our choir this morning, through God's word this morning, what will you do with what you have heard? You step out and come. You respond. The altar is open. Come and pray. A couple of deacons will be up here. Come and talk with one of them if you have questions, if we can help you with anything. If you want to know more about knowing Jesus, if you want to know more about being a part of this church family, if you want to know more about following a believer's baptism, or if you want to know more about what God wants to do with your life, that's the knowledge that we want to share. Will you partake? You respond. Come.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after
this morning. The youth will have their Christmas party tonight from 5 to 7:30 in the youth room. Just a reminder about the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. You can still give through the end of the month for that. We're getting close to our church goal. And don't forget, also tied to that is hopefully when you give, when you can use our Lottie Moon Christmas post office back there. There's cards back there for a lot of you guys, so please check that as you leave today. But that's a time, the postage you're saving from that, not mailing things, hopefully you'll give towards the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. That goes, 100% of it goes to foreign missions, so I hope you'll be a part of giving towards that. Also, December 24th, Christmas Eve's candlelight service will be here, 6 o'clock, and I hope you will join us for that. No Wednesday evening activities the next 2 weeks.
And close us in a word of prayer, and then we're going to sing a chorus together as we close our service out. Sing it loud.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and earth and nature.
As is our tradition from my family to you all, as you go out today, for each family, we do have our Christmas ornament, our annual Christmas ornament.